Hey all, hope everybody are doing good. Welcome to homeschool and we are back with class 11 chemistry. The chapter is hydrocarbons. In our previous videos, we have discussed everything about preparation of alkanes. See, as I already told you, this chapter includes the study of alkanes, alkenes, alkynes and aromatic hydrocarbons. We are actually with alkanes. We completed introduction part and we have seen the different types of isomerisms possible. And then we went for discussing the preparation methods of alkanes. And now coming to a last topic on alkanes, that is properties of alkanes. The moment you talk about the property of organic compounds, there are two types of properties. One is physical properties. So physical properties is all about the discussion about boiling point, melting point, the way they exist in nature, and it's all about the discussion on solubility. Okay, so only certain physical aspects we discuss about the compounds. And next property is chemical property. This is what very important for competitive exams. In case of chemical properties, we discuss all the possible reactions that alkanes undergo. So with what type of organic compounds they react, how they react, what are the new organic compounds that can be formed from reactions, all that we will discuss under chemical properties. So first, let me talk about physical properties. So as I already told you, physical properties includes the discussion on the nature of compounds, I mean how they exist in our nature, whether they exist as gas, liquid or solids. And coming to this alkanes, as I already told you in my first video, that alkanes are inert at room temperature, right? So what do you mean by inert? Inert in the sense they do not react with anything at room temperature. They do not react with acids, they do not react with bases, and they do not react with anything. Okay, so that is the reason actually they are called with the name paraffins, isn't it? So that's the reason you don't find too many reactions with alkanes, because they don't react. And whatever reactions you observe, everything you will observe at certain temperature, not at room temperature. Right? So this is one very important aspect one must remember. And coming to the second factor, you know, the lower alkanes in the sense, alkanes which have got less number of carbon atoms. For example, methane, ethane, propane, you know, butane, all these are called lower alkanes. Okay? For example, methane, ethane C2H6, propane C3H8, and then butane C4H10. So these are called lower alkanes. Lower alkanes always exist as gases in our nature. So if you have seen methane, we call it as methane gas. So when we use butane, you know, butane is used in cooking gas cylinder, isn't it? So butane is always existed as a gas. So the lower members always exist as gases. And later, the middle members, I mean to say from C5 to C17. In the sense, alkane having 5 carbon atoms to alkane having 17 carbon atoms. You know, they are called middle members of alkanes. So these middle members always exist as liquids. And finally, after C18, I mean C18 and above C18, okay? So C18 and above. So these alkanes are called higher alkanes. In the sense, the carbon chain is really very long. Okay, so it will have 18 carbon atoms and above 18. You can have 20, 25 carbons and 30 carbons and whatnot. So when alkanes have very big carbon chain, they are called higher alkanes and they always exist as solids, right? So all alkanes are not gases. only the lower members, that is from C1 to C4. So these alkanes are gases, middle alkanes are liquids, and higher alkanes are solids. So this is the things on which how they exist in our nature, right? Okay, and coming to very important factor, solubility. So can you think of whether alkanes soluble in water? No, alkanes are hydrophobic in nature. You know, alkanes are hydrophobic in the sense they do not dissolve in water. So what do you mean by hydrophobic? Do not dissolve in water. Okay. So always in our chemistry, there is one very famous saying that like dissolves like. So what do you mean by like dissolves like? Polar solutes dissolve in polar solvents. Non-polar solutes dissolve in non-polar solvents. Polar solutes in the sense the solutes which have charges like positive ion and negative ion. So those polar solutes dissolve in polar solvent only. The best example is water. It has got positive ion and negative ion, right? Whereas organic compounds are non-polar. They do not carry any charges, right? So these organic compounds dissolve in organic solvents only. They do not dissolve in water. So that is what the meaning of this particular word, like dissolves like. Clear? Fine. So that means it's very clear that these alkanes do not, they do not soluble in water. Okay, fine. And later, let us talk about the fourth factor, I mean the last factor, boiling point. Boiling point. So, you know, in case of alkanes, as carbon number increases, boiling point always increases. Okay, so that means in case of methane, you have only one carbon. In case of ethane, two carbons. Propane, three carbons. So, among methane, ethane and propane, which one can have more boiling point? Definitely propane, because more carbon atoms are there. So, more the carbon atoms, I mean, longest the chain, more is the boiling point because the mass increases, right? So the mass of propane is greater than methane. Mass increases and then the attractive forces, whatever the weak attractive forces you have in a molecule, all of them will also increase. Automatically the boiling point increases. Okay, so as the carbon number increases, I mean carbon chain increases, boiling point increases. And another important point that you need to remember under boiling point is, as branching increases, boiling point decreases. Very important point. Okay, as branching increases, boiling point decreases. So what do you mean by this? For example, I will take isomers of pentane. Okay, so we have seen in our first class how to write isomers of pentane, isn't it? Say we can write pentane in three different forms: CH3, CH2, 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 CH3. So this is N pentane. So the other way of writing pentane is this, so which we will call it as isopentane, right? So 5 carbon atoms, but it is branched. And the third isomer of pentane is this one, which we will call it as neopentane, isn't it? So in all the three compounds, you have 5 carbon atoms and you have how many hydrogens? 3 plus 2, 5, 12 hydrogens. So this has 5 carbons and 12 hydrogens. This also has 5 carbons and 12 hydrogens. And this also has 5 carbons and 12 hydrogens, isn't it? But you know what, this shows more boiling point than this, and this shows more boiling point than the last one. Okay, say if I represent this structure as 1 and this as 2 and this as 3, you know, 3 has lesser boiling point than 2, 2 has lesser boiling point than 1. So more the branching, lesser is the boiling point. So highly branched structure is the third one, isn't it? So more the branches, lesser is the boiling point. So why? It is because the surface area occupied is less. So how much is the space occupied by first compound? It is huge. You know, you can see when I have to write its structure, I'm taking this much space, isn't it? So surface occupied by this molecule is actually large, whereas the surface area occupied by this molecule is very small, right? So boiling point actually depends on surface area, right? So lesser the surface area molecule occupies, lesser will be the boiling point, right? Okay, so based on this concept, you know, we always tell this point, as branching increases, boiling point always decreases. So it's quite an important point regarding boiling point that you need to follow. So that is all about the physical properties of alkanes. Now we will go for very, very important chemical properties. See students, under chemical properties, we have reactions like substitution reaction. See, this is the most important and useful reaction from which we can prepare haloalkanes. Clear? And the next reaction is very, very common reaction you must have observed in a day-to-day life, that is combustion reaction. Third one is isomerization. So that means formation of isomers. So from one isomer, you can prepare another isomer. For example, you have pentane, isn't it? You have n-pentane, you have 2-methylbutane, and you have neopentane. See, from n-pentane, you can actually prepare the other isomer. You can prepare 2-methylbutane, right? So like that, from one isomer, you can prepare the other one. Such reactions are isomerization. And next one is aromatization. Aromatization is nothing but preparation of aromatic compounds. Aromatic is benzene and benzene related compounds. Those compounds you can prepare from alkanes. So this is one of the very, very important reaction that you need to concentrate. Next is very simple reaction. Reaction with steam. Reaction with steam. And finally, you have a reaction called pyrolysis. So these are the major chemical properties or chemical reactions of alkanes. And now we will discuss one by one in a detailed way. Coming to the first reaction, substitution reaction. So as the name suggests, you know, we take alkanes and we will heat alkanes in presence of halogen. Halogens are generally represented with X. Actually, substitution can also be called as, one of the type of substitution reaction is halogenation. That means actually we are adding halogens to whom? To alkanes. And addition of halogens is always done in presence of sunlight. Okay, you can either use sunlight or you can heat the reaction at high temperature. What actually happens is the hydrogen atoms of alkane gets substituted by chlorine atoms or any halogen atom. Clear? So such a reaction is called substitution reaction. So if hydrogens of alkane gets substituted by halogens, you get so-called haloalkanes as the product. Haloalkanes are very, very important type of organic compound which can be used in a varieties of ways. Okay, so such important haloalkanes you can prepare from alkane. By which reaction? By substitution reaction. Clear? So let us see one example here. Let me take the example as chlorination of methane. So you have something called chlorination of methane. That means you are actually substituting hydrogens of methane by chlorine atoms. So such a reaction is chlorination of methane. So you can observe this reaction here. Let me take very simple alkane, methane. So for this, when I heat, I add chlorine and I heat the reaction, or I use the sunlight here when I expose methane in presence of sunlight, and when I treat it with Cl2, see, one of the hydrogen of methane gets substituted by chlorine atom. So what is the product you will get? CH3. See, among the four, one I'm removing, in that place I'm adding one Cl atom. So I get CH3Cl as the product. So the name of this compound is chloromethane. And what is the byproduct you get? One hydrogen and one more Cl atom is remaining, right? So both of them combine and you get HCl. So this is the best example of chlorination of methane. And you know, now if I take CH3Cl, for this, if I add one more molecule of chlorine in presence of sunlight, what happens is the second hydrogen atom gets substituted by chlorine. So if I remove one more hydrogen and I put one more Cl in this place, what do I get? I get CH2Cl2 plus HCl. So what is this called? Dichloromethane. This is called dichloromethane. And now if I take this CH2Cl2 and I add chlorine in presence of sunlight, what happens is the third hydrogen, one more hydrogen gets substituted by chlorine, you get CHCl3. So commonly it is called as chloroform, and IUPAC name for this compound is trichloromethane. Okay, so in case CHCl3, again I'll treat it with chlorine in presence of sunlight. So that last hydrogen, whatever is there, that also gets replaced by chlorine, and you will get CCl4, which we will call it as tetrachloromethane. Okay, so this is what we call chain reaction. You can either replace one hydrogen, two hydrogens, three hydrogens, and all the four hydrogens from methane by Cl atoms. You get different types of haloalkanes as the product, right? And the mechanism here is very, very interesting. The mechanism in the sense, exactly how a reaction takes place stepwise. Okay, so that is called mechanism. So mechanism is actually a free radical mechanism. So free radicals are formed as intermediates, so it is called free radical mechanism. Okay, so remember the type of mechanism here. So as I already told you, any organic reaction mechanism involves the formation of intermediates, right? So here the intermediate formed is free radicals. Actually, free radicals initiate the reaction. Okay, so let us discuss few aspects of mechanism here. See, mechanism involves three steps, guys. First one is initiation. In case of initiation, what happens is Cl2 is there, no? How do I write Cl2? Cl bond Cl. Cl2 is nothing but Cl bond Cl. Okay, so this Cl bond Cl in presence of sunlight undergoes homolytic bond cleavage. So we have studied in the previous chapter what was homolytic bond cleavage. So bond in the sense two electrons. So one electron goes to one atom, the other electron goes to another atom. So bond is cleaved in such a way that one electron goes to one atom, the other electron goes to another atom. Okay, so you get Cl free radical and another Cl free radical. So this is what we call initiation. Okay, so in the initiation step, free radical formation takes place. Okay, now the next step is propagation. So here actually these products are formed. So I will show you how this product is formed initially. Okay, so you have CH4, isn't it? And that reacts with one of the free radical, one of the chlorine free radical. Okay, so CH4, I will write it as CH3 bond H. Okay, so this chlorine free radical actually provokes, it encourages homolytic bond cleavage of this bond. So in presence of this free radical, you will observe homolytic bond cleavage in the methane molecule. So you will observe the formation of CH3 free radical. Okay. So plus H free radical, Cl free radical will combine and you get HCl. So now what is left out? CH3 free radical is left out. And there is one more Cl free radical now. So both of them will combine. This free radical combines and you get the first product CH3Cl. Okay, so that is how by free radical mechanism you are getting the different products. Okay, and the last step here is chain termination. Like you have to terminate the reaction, right? So in case of termination step, if any free radicals are left out, they combine and you get the different products. For example, see, if there is any H free radical left out, that can combine with Cl free radical. In case if this is left out after the formation of all products, if these free radicals are left out in any case, so they combine and you get HCl. Okay, like that. So if extra free radicals are left out, they would combine and you get different products. And here, very very special product you get. In case if CH3 free radicals are left out after the formation of all these compounds, you know, say both of them would combine and you get a very special compound, CH3 bond CH3, which is nothing but ethane. So you have chances of getting ethane as byproduct. Okay, so this is all about the mechanism. So this is what we mean by substitution reaction. Okay, fine. Now we will go for the second reaction, combustion reaction. See guys, combustion reactions are actually very very simple. We have studied this in our lower classes also. It's nothing but heating an organic compound in presence of oxygen. You are burning an organic compound. So whenever you burn, for example, whenever you burn carbon in presence of oxygen, you get carbon dioxide, right? This is a form of combustion we call. Combustion of carbon, right? Suppose you have methane. So when I burn in presence of oxygen, what do I get? Carbon dioxide, water, and lots of energy, right? Combustion reactions are always exothermic reactions. Exothermic reactions in the sense, lots of heat is always liberated during the reaction. Okay, so whenever you do combustion of an alkane, you will always end up in getting carbon dioxide, water, and energy. So combustion is always like a burning in presence of oxygen, right? So but here balancing is very very important. How do you balance this equation? See, one carbon, fine, two hydrogens, so I'll put two here. Coming to oxygens, two oxygens, so here only two are there. Altogether four oxygen, so we'll put two. So combustion of methane, in the sense, this is what the reaction. Okay, so if I ask you to write equation for combustion of ethane is what? C2H6, isn't it? So combustion of ethane means what? It's always burning in presence of oxygen, and what are the products you always get? It's always carbon dioxide and water. But how do you balance this? Let's try to balance. Two carbons, so I'll put two here. Six hydrogens, two hydrogens, so I'll put three here. Coming to oxygen, there are two oxygens here and here. 2 into 2, 4. 4 plus 3, 7. So altogether, 7 oxygens this side, but only 2 oxygens this side. Isn't it? So how do you make it 7? If you put number 2 here, you will get 4. If you put 3, you will get 6. If you put 4, you will get 8. If you put 3, you get 6. If you put 4, you get 8. But you want 7 oxygens this side. There are 7 here. You want to show 7 here. How do you do that? Right? So balancing is very very important in this case. So you want 7 oxygens, right? So what you can do is introduce fraction initially, put 7/2, and you can't keep fraction for balancing. So what I do, the whole equation multiply by 2. Okay, see how many ever oxygens you want this side, that put it as a fraction. I want 7. I want to show 7 this side because 7 oxygens are there this side. Okay. So I want 7 this side. So I have introduced 7 by 2. Now I need to remove a fraction. So I multiply the whole equation by 2. Okay. So when I multiply by 2, what do I get? I get 2C2H6 plus this 2 and this 2 gets cancelled. I get 7O2. 2 2s are 4CO2 plus 3 2s are 6H2O. So now you see 2 into 2, 4 carbons. Here also 4 carbons. Hydrogens, 2 6 are 12 and here also 6 2s are 12 hydrogens. Coming to oxygens, 7 2s are 14, 4 2s are 8, right? 8 plus 6, it's 14. Isn't it? So this is how you will try to balance the combustion reaction. So balancing is very, very important here. So nothing much to discuss about combustion. It's like a complete oxidation reaction. Okay. Coming to the third reaction, that is, what is that? Isomerization. Isomerization. It's a very, very simple reaction. So let me take an example of hexane. Okay, so hexane, how do you write? CH3, CH2, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons. Okay, so this is our N hexane. So this N hexane, in case if I heat with anhydrous aluminium chloride in presence of HCl. You know, this is the reagent you will use for isomerization. What we are doing is, this is one isomer of hexane. But from this, I'm going to generate the other isomers. Okay. So now, when I heat this, I will take two molecules of this and I'm heating in presence of this reagent. Reagent is very, very important to remember. So for isomerization, anhydrous aluminium chloride in HCl is used. Okay, so I can able to make, you know, observe this, CH3, CH2, CH2, CH3. So what is this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It is actually 2-methyl pentane. You can either get 2-methyl pentane and you can also get 3-methyl pentane, CH3, CH3, CH2, CH3. Okay, so this is 2-methyl pentane and this is 3-methyl pentane. See, actually this, this and this, all the three are isomers. From this isomer, I could able to prepare remaining two isomers, right? So this is how preparation of isomers is called isomerization. The reagent is important to remember. Clear? Fine. Let's go for the next reaction, that is aromatization. Aromatization. So we are going to prepare aromatic compounds from alkanes. Okay. So you take an alkane and when you heat this in presence of either vanadium pentoxide or chromium oxide or molybdenum oxide. Okay. This is vanadium pentoxide, chromium oxide, molybdenum oxide. Any oxide you can use, and when you heat this, the alkane gets converted into aromatic compound. Aromatic compound. Suppose, let me take 6 carbon containing alkane. So what is 6 carbon containing alkane? Hexane. So what is the formula of hexane? It is, let me write it in this way, just to show the reaction in a convenient way. So this is our hexane, right? CH2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is our hexane. I just wrote it this way. Okay. So when I heat this in presence of any of the oxide, what happens is removal of hydrogen takes place. What happens? Removal of hydrogen takes place. Okay, so when I remove hydrogens, you know, from all the carbons, I get, you know, when you take 6 carbon containing alkane, you get 6 carbon containing aromatic compound. Which is the 6 carbon containing aromatic compound? Benzene. So everywhere actually what is there? Carbon is there. Carbon is there with one hydrogen. Right? So this is what we call aromatization. You know, if you take 7 carbon containing alkane, you get 7 carbon containing aromatic compound. Okay, so this is how we can prepare aromatic compounds from alkanes. Such reactions are called aromatization. Right? Now, coming to very, very simple reaction, reaction with steam. See, coming to reaction with steam. So here we will see how methane reacts with steam. So this methane, when it reacts with steam in presence of a catalyst, here catalyst is very much essential. So nickel is used as catalyst, and you will get carbon monoxide and hydrogen gas. Okay. So this is actually one of the very, very important reactions. This is how you can prepare hydrogen industrially. Whenever you want to prepare hydrogen in a bulk amount, we go for this reaction. Okay, so that's why one of the very, very important reaction I said. And coming to last reaction, pyrolysis. So pyro, the word pyro means heating. Okay, heating. What do you mean by lysis? Lysis in the sense breaking, isn't it? So we are breaking something with the help of heating. Okay, so what can we break? Alkanes. Which alkanes can we break? Higher alkanes. Higher alkanes in the sense, alkanes which have more number of carbon atoms. For example, let me take hexane. Hexane. What is hexane? CH3, CH2, 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 CH3. So how many carbon atoms? 6. How many hydrogen atoms? 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, right? So this is hexane. So this hexane, I can break in number of ways. If I use very high temperature, okay? So when I use very high temperature, this hexane can get broken up into C6H12 plus hydrogen. So what do you mean by C6H12? Hexene. Okay, so two hydrogen atoms will come out on heating and you get C6H12 plus H2. So this is one way of breaking hexane. See, now I can also break this particular compound in another way. You know, when I heat it, this compound can also be broken into C4H8 plus C2H6. So what is C2H6? It is ethane. What is C4H8? It is butene. It is butene. So this is another way of breaking this compound. But if you add this and this, you will get hexane, right? If you add this and this, you will get hexane, right? So there are different ways of breaking a higher alkane. Okay. So there is another way of breaking the same compound, guys. So when I heat it, I can also break down into C3H6 plus C2H4 plus CH4. Okay, so what is C2H4? It is ethene. What is CH4? It is methane. What is C3H6? That is CH2CH CH3. So what is this? It is propene. You will get propene, right? You will get ethene and you will also get methane. So this is another way of breaking hexane. So higher alkane, depending on the different temperatures, you know, you can break it in different ways. So breaking an higher alkane on heating is called as pyrolysis. So all these are different chemical reactions of alkanes. Okay, so with this, I have completed alkanes in a very much detailed way. I have covered every topic and everything is important for competitive examination. So do practice all the reactions and remember the reagent's name. Okay. So in my next video, I will come up with alkenes. Let's discuss introduction of alkene, isomerism in alkene, preparations and chemical properties. Thank you so much. Do subscribe our channel to learn the concepts in an easiest way and in a detailed way. See you in the next class.